Cammons. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at Harvard University School of Engineering and Applied Sciences. And today I'm here to talk about a postdoc and scholarly research now and the future. So just a little bit about me. I'm a postdoctoral research fellow in the Harvard Biorobotics and Microrobotics Laboratories. And my research focuses on humanoid robotics and medical devices. And I realized that a lot of people were more interested in what I have to say about engineering than library access, so I kind of cut a lot of those slides out this morning. A lot of the conversations led right into my engineering rather than some of my comments and some of my colleagues' comments on library access. So that might shorten things up a bit. I've authored in several publications in electrical, mechanical, and biomedical engineering, so I have a fair amount of experience in publishing and gaining access to other publications I need to start new research. This presentation is the result of collaboration with several colleagues at Harvard University, Carnegie Mellon, and even some library staff from Harvard, Carnegie Mellon, and University of Pennsylvania. So this is not just a unilateral treatise on scholarly research from my perspective, but it actually envelops a lot of people's perspectives, and I thought that might give you a better feel and inform you a little better than just giving my own perspective of the past 11 years of experience that I have. So essentially I'm going to talk about first the importance of libraries in research, and I think everybody knows they're fairly well intertwined and one can't go without the other. Talk about common modes of access, the trends we have in engineering and technical science. Talk a little bit about a illustrative research example, and again, I cut out a lot of the slides just so attention won't be drawn away from the topic of interest, but I'll give you a very brief example of what that's like for us. And then I'll move on to some of the problems we have with limited access, and I think everybody's very interested to hear about that. There was initially a lot of vitriol from my colleagues and I about not having access to publications we need to do research, but after having talked to several of you and realizing what, you know, bright and hardworking people you are, it's kind of hard to be mad about this. I understand it's a business, and a lot of it's about economics and not about you not wanting us to get our research done. So. This is going to have a much more, I think, relaxed tone than it did initially. And I'll end up talking about how scholars see libraries of the future. And it's I think you'll be surprised to hear how satisfied we already are with the infrastructure of library access. We don't want much to change. We'd like to see different types of media, but we're pretty happy with the way things are, other than the fact that we can't get access to some, and only a small portion of the literature that we need. So I think this goes without saying, the library is at the heart of academic research. There's no research project I know of that hasn't started at the library. And scholarly publications are essentially the currency for the academy. This is how we gauge our research progress. This is how academics equate the research publications and research aptitude to the amount of output and the amount of efficiency in the research labs. And commercial publishers provided a valuable form for the dissemination and circulation of this knowledge. And we realize that's very important, and that's why we pretty much, we're okay with the way things are right now. I think it works very well for us, albeit for a price. Some of the benefits of having commercial publishing rather than open access at this point, it standardizes data formats and the submission process, the review process, and publication. Something we don't really want to think about as technical scientists and engineers. And it gives us greater research visibility. Well, we could always post publications on our websites and try to do things like sell our articles on Amazon, but if it's available worldwide, there's a much greater possibility that we're gonna have greater collaborations, better technical impact on our particular fields. So how do we access information? I don't think this is a surprise to anybody, but library access, according to my colleagues and I, the research we've done, well, I think the aggregate is like 80-something years, so it's not that great, but it's a bunch of junior faculty and postdocs like myself. 75% of it comes from the library, and about 90 to 95% of that is remote, so it's all digital. I think the only time we go to a library is when we can't access something digitally and we want to get an interlibrary loan, or in some cases, I guess there's other forms or other methods of getting these than in a library loan, special websites or something we can only access in the physical library itself. About 15 to 20% of the information we need for research comes from collaborative exchange, so just peer-to-peer conversations at you know, seminars and conferences, research collaborations if you're sharing a grant with someone. And about 5 to 10% of the research we need, the information we need for research comes from our own hard work and the nascent technology and science that comes from that. So overall, the library access comprises a huge component of the information we need, and obviously it's vital that we have better access in order to continue our research. So this is an example of a research project, and I won't get into the details. So I said I work in robotic, humanoid robotics, and part of that is robotic manipulation. It's a really big field. It's been studied for 30 years, and there's a lot of good work going on in that field. But this, despite the fact that the work is really good, it actually makes it a lot harder to do research because so many of the salient points within this field have been researched already. And so most research projects start out with a literature survey, and it's no different in my fields. We start with surveying anywhere from 25 to 100 papers, maybe more if you're just getting started in that particular field. If you're very well reputed and you've got a good knowledge base, maybe 10, 20 papers you have to read to get up to speed on what other researchers in your field have been doing. And that comprises much of the research space. So the blue dots there represent publications or some research that other institutions have been doing. From those 25 to 100 papers, we may pick 10 to 30 that really give us critical content, meaning equations and empirical data and different types of mechanical drawings, things that we can expand upon and refine to make our research a little bit better than the competitor or the previous research. I mean, after all, the point is to make a scientific contribution, not just to copy someone else's work. I forgot to point out that some of these are seminal papers or seminal research topics that help the entire field. So it helps the researcher to be well aware of these and to know them inside and out. And their ability to cite these papers or to read these papers and then cite them is crucial to their own publications getting accepted. And from these 10 to 30 papers, we can define subspaces in the research space that are ripe for scientific contribution, and we can then do research that's pointed toward those areas. And typically, in my fields in engineering, the point moved for some reason. Publications range from anywhere from 1 to 3, and as many as 5, depending upon the size of the research project and how many collaborators you have. But essentially, we're taking a bunch of information, maybe 100 papers, getting it down to 10, 30 papers that are really relevant, and we're producing 1 to 5 that we put back into that research space. Okay, so that is the typical research project. I know it's really high level and you might have a lot of questions about that, but I think that pretty much goes across the board, not just in engineering and technical science, but social sciences and arts and all those things. So I didn't bother going into too much detail there. But now I want to talk about something I think you all want to hear about, and that's how we cope with limited access. So for the particular project that I just mentioned, from discussions with my colleagues, anywhere from 10 to 15% of the relevant literature that they need for the research is unobtainable. And that's usually because the libraries don't have digital access to those. In some cases, we'll take the time to get interlibrary loan, but those can take anywhere from a couple days to weeks. And if we're in a crunch and we're writing a paper or we have to get a grant proposal out, we're not gonna have time to wait for that. And so a lot of times researchers end up suffering from this at the point of the grant proposal reviews and the research paper reviews. And in this case, I actually didn't do so bad. I wanted to get access to research papers for my project, and the total number was 42. At Harvard, I could get access to 36 of them, and all of them were relevant papers. There were a couple in there that I couldn't get a hold of that I think are seminal, but I didn't need them for that particular project. 38 at Carnegie Mellon, 26 at University of Pennsylvania. So across the board, I think at the top tier universities, access to academic literature is pretty good, but this is talking about R1 schools that have a lot of money and bigger library budgets. If you talk about lower tier schools, they're gonna suffer a lot more. They might see anywhere 25, 30 papers or even less. And so that puts them at a big disadvantage when competing with larger universities. And invariably, when we have issues with access, we complain to librarians. And that goes across the board, faculty members, postdocs, graduate students, undergrads. We all run to the library and say, why isn't this here? We want access to this, and we have everything else we need, just not this one important paper. And we don't bother thinking about the economics behind the library process. And that's because we're so well insulated from it. We just go to one of the publisher's websites, try to get access to the file, and if we can't get the PDF or whatever form the research paper's in, we just go complain. Which makes sense, that's what students do, and postdocs. And I think just talking to a bunch of you here, I realize how difficult it is to balance a budget and satisfy faculty and researchers. Even when the school has a lot of money, the bundles that are purchased, and I'm not gonna act like I know much about this, and I can't talk too intelligently about it, but some of the bundles that are purchased by the libraries includes research topics that are basically much less profitable, so social arts and sciences, that they want to wrap up in these bundles so that the research, or so the university will buy these also. And the ones that we do want, the higher end journals tend to have subscription bundles that are maybe one or two journals, I guess, and if we want access to those, we have to pay a lot more, and sometimes the libraries just aren't willing or are unable to endeavor for that. So I was saying the less popular fields lose research visibility. I think that's the reason that these bundles are wrapped up the way they are. They include higher end journals and some of the smaller ones, but when the researchers in my fields are missing a couple of papers that they need, we really don't think about that. And that's kind of mean-spirited to say that the smaller fields don't matter so much, but in essence, they don't to us. If we can't get the papers we need and it affects our research, that's what we're gonna complain about first, regardless of what the current system does for the smaller research fields. So, of course, we're pretty innovative and improvising people. We learn to adapt to these situations, and part of the way we do that is we seek secondhand acquisition. And essentially, that happens through, yeah, you see a little smiley face, so I was kind of taking a poke at you, but we'll contact the authors of papers directly, if need be. And this is not to undermine the publishers or cheat the library access system. This is out of need for seminal publications that will lend itself to the research lab survival. And oftentimes, if a research lab, or in particular, an individual student who's writing a paper, doesn't cite a particular seminal paper in that field because they couldn't read it, they're gonna get penalized during the review process. I review about anywhere from 8 to 12 papers a year, and one of the criteria that a lot of the professional societies want you to look at is how well they cited previous research. And I feel really bad for papers that come through from smaller universities that didn't cite the bigger papers, and my first inclination is to think that they just didn't have access. I can't say that they didn't try hard enough or they didn't look hard enough. They probably just didn't get the research that they needed from their library. And I don't think that that should be something they have to deal with, at least not to the extent that it affects their research and doesn't allow them to pursue their career. Direct from author also comes from not just writing them and asking or calling them and asking them for the papers, but some faculty members and researchers also post links on their webpage to manuscripts, or they'll actually have them on the server so people can download files. And I've seen a lot less of that recently, so I don't know if that's a crackdown or there's some legal issues behind that, but that's starting to fade. But definitely the direct from author secondhand acquisition still happens quite a bit. And I've had to do it myself a couple of times. I'm not gonna, you know, wash my hands and say I haven't taken part in that. I've had to do it a couple of times to stay afloat. So other than trying to work around it, I think we're trying to push for an evolution in the publication paradigm. And essentially that means we start to look toward open access or away from the publishers that are harder to gain access from. And this essentially means a reduction in commercial article citation and publications that we submit to these commercial publishers. And one of the reasons we want to do this is to eliminate penalizing authors for lack of these expensive citations, like I just mentioned earlier. A smaller school doesn't have access to the same resources, and it's not fair that they can do just as high quality work as we do, but can't get it published because they don't say this author or this particular research lab inspired our research. And we're also changing our perspective on the impact factor. So I guess you're all familiar with the perish or publish mindset, where universities and individual researchers want to publish as much as they can in the highest end research journals and conference proceedings that they can find. And this is, of course, because this gets them bigger grant dollars. It looks better on your CV if you're going to apply for an academic job or your resume and an industry job. But we also realize that publishing in these journals This allows access for some of the students or researchers in smaller schools. So we're trying to move away from that. I think we're a little bit heavy-footed just because of the fact that we're still kind of in love with the prestige that comes with the scarcity of publication in these big journals or these big conference proceedings. So we have to kind of take a step back and reevaluate what's more important to us, the growth of the fields that we're working in, and the growth of smaller universities, or if we want to just keep publishing in the higher-end journals and getting all the credit when we know that other researchers are doing good work and just can't get it out there because they don't have the money. So that's essentially how we cope with limited access. I could go into a lot more details, and I'm sure you have questions, so I kind of save some of that for later. But we do kind of cheat to get around some of the bottlenecks or some of the barriers to access. And again, that's because of survival, not to undermine the publishers. So how do we see libraries of the future? Well, I think everybody that I talked to said they were very satisfied with the current system. It's usually very easy to get access if the library, in fact, has the publication, subscription for the publications that we need. And it's usually very easy to get access no matter where we're at. We don't have to be in a physical library or even VPN sometimes. If we have a certificate on our computer, when we log into the publisher's website, we can still get the publications we need. We don't want any fancy interfaces. We don't care about the bells and whistles. Just get us our papers and get them to us quickly and for the right price so we can have as many as we need for our research. Database searchability was a funny topic. Most of us use, you know, Bing and Google Scholar to do our searches, but when we actually go to the websites, we find it incredibly hard sometimes to find a particular paper. Even though we give the author name and the title, it comes up with something completely obscure. So that's another point that I think deserves some attention. Not so much the interfaces, but the actual searchability. As far as additions to the type of media that we can gain access to, we certainly like to see more research videos, and I think a lot of publishers already do a good job of that. Something that I haven't seen anywhere, and none of my colleagues either, are CAD drawings and source code and other things that researchers can share open source that makes the acquisition of the data and the use of that data a lot more efficient. So we can read a paper, and after we read the paper, we want to see the source code or the mechanical drawings for a particular device that we want to try and implement in our own labs, and we have to go and contact the individual research labs or the PIs and what have you, and sometimes that can take a long time just because they're so busy. And if we could have these right at our fingertips on your websites, that would be a great help to us. And I've encountered several situations where I wanted some source code for a particular software algorithm, and it took me several weeks to get the researcher's permission, and they said they would have readily given it to the publisher if that were an option. So, and another thing, I don't know how many people even use these anymore. I just saw them for several months back in 07, but they're 3D-enabled PDFs, and so you can include mechanical drawings and 3D renderings of different objects or different data and be able to fully manipulate these without going to an external software package. So those are several of the things that we hope you keep in mind moving forward when you're trying to evolve your websites and your access paradigms. Another thing we look forward to for libraries of the future is just wider access in general, not just to the publications that we're looking for, but also to these interactive media. And we don't think that it has to be, we don't think that we need open access to attain the level of the bandwidth that we need for our workflow. We think that if the pricing were a little bit different, sit here and claim to understand the economics behind your business models, but if the pricing were more friendly for the research institutions and we can get a hold of all of this data much more quickly, I don't think you would hear any complaints at all. In fact, even with the problems I've had with access to certain articles that I needed for my research, I would be more than willing to pay a few bucks if I had to get it. In fact, a couple of cases I paid $35-$40 for an article, and I don't want to pay that much, don't get me wrong. That wasn't what I was shooting for, but I had to do it at the time, so I did it. But if it were $15-$20 and students were given some type of stipend to purchase articles to make the use of these articles more efficient, I think you would see that, you know, no student would have a problem, or no researcher would have a problem with how things are priced, and I think the librarians would be appreciative of that as well. A couple of random ideas we came up with. We were doing some ideation, and one thing we thought was really interesting was the pay to submit and publish. I don't know if anybody's even considered this or is trying to implement this, but if you force a researcher to pay a small fee up front to submit a publication, it'll reduce the number of poor publications that are in circulation and reduce the number of papers that we have to review. I think the number of papers we have to review is just increasing exponentially, and it's been doing so since 1990, and I don't think it's going to stop anytime soon. Universities are getting increasingly bigger, and the Asian and European researchers are starting to take a much more focused look at publishing in the U.S. and trying to establish themselves in certain fields as well. So I see that only increasing, and this would provide a way of making sure that the quality of the publication didn't have to suffer as a result of the increased amount of research being done. So in summary, again, library access we know is essential to academic research. You provide a valuable service for all of us in streamlining the research publication review process. We improve the quality and visibility of our research, so we don't really have a problem with that at all. It's just the limitations in access. Outside of that, I think we're pretty happy with the current system. Again, fancy apps and ubiquitous access are not necessary. I see people with iPads and Barnes & Noble Nooks and all these things. It's nice to have the ability to read these things while you're at work, but I think the last thing that a lot of us want is a way for our work to follow us home. So mobile apps for our Blackberries and iPhones and all that is something we really, a lot of people cringe at that thought. They just want to leave things at work. They're going to be very efficient while they're there, and then once they go home, they don't want their work to follow them. So I think I already mentioned the other points. Rigorous review leads to higher quality research and prestige in the publications that we are able to push through. So in general, just, you know, keep up the good work and maybe step down the prices just a little bit. And we'll be much happier researchers, and we won't be needing open access. We won't be pushing toward that so steadfastly. So that's all I have. I want to acknowledge the, again, the collaborators or the people I have conversations with at Harvard University in the Biorobotics and Microrobotics Labs, at CERLAB, the Computational Engineering Robotics Laboratory at Carnegie Mellon, where I earned my PhD, and the library staff from Harvard, Carnegie Mellon, and University, who were surprisingly open and very candid when giving responses to some of my questions, and I really appreciate their time also. Thank you.